Shalom. I really enjoyed this evening worship with the worship team, the backup singer, the drummer, the pianist, and all of you singing. I can hear Sister Lulu and Brother Willie Lord voice all away from there, like echoing the song. Really enjoyable singing together with you all, worshiping God. Yeah. I'd like you to maybe greet your neighbor and say, may the peace of God be with you. Greet your neighbor. Today is the 35th day of war in Gaza. After the surprise visit, I think all you had read the news on October 7th, slaughtered many celebrating a festival, more than 1,200 died, including children, baby, women, and several hundred had taken into hostage. We heard how Israelite retaliated, isn't it? And wow, to eradicate Hamas, the terrorists in the land of a small, tiny strip called Gaza. And they have implemented a total blockage. Cut off all the utility, supply, internet, phone, water, electricity, food, and so on. And the continuous bombing, 35 days. And innocents are caught in between of this war. War is ugly, isn't it? War is really ugly. You know, the world is a global village. What happened in a corner of the world immediately be known by all parts of the world. We have now heard the protest or seen the protest in the news, demonstration, march from all over the world, and on both camps, right? Pro-Palestinian or pro-Israelite. You know, conflict between Israel and Palestinian, although it just worsened and intensified recently, but we know it happened long ago. Over the last 80 years, it's worse, but you will go back in history, maybe 1,000 years back. Who is right? Who is wrong? It's not easy for us to really judge. We can only do as a good Christian, believing in God, and pray for peace. Pray for peace for them, for the innocent, for the Christian, isn't it? War is horrible. War is ugly. I think we will pause for a moment. I'd like to let us spend a little bit of time to pray for the innocent and pray for this country at war. Remember, Ukraine war started almost 2 years until now as well. So let's pray. Commit all this to God. Dear God and Father, we praise you that we can come before your throne of grace. The mercy and the grace that you have given to us. We thank you that you are the awesome God, majestic and holy. We praise you that you are sovereign over all. We know that all the affairs in the world will not happen without your sovereign view over it. Although we could not understand, but you know and you have taught us that, Lord, to pray for peace, to love even our enemies. So we have to pray against this war that happened in Gaza, in Ukraine, with Russia, then between Israelite and Palestine. We pray against all the killing that happened, the evil, the wickedness, the deceit that we heard day after day, over the news, over the internet, over the social media. Lord, we pray against all those. We know it is against you and against your personality. We pray for peace instead. We pray for protection over the innocent. We pray that the fear of you will over the leader, those that have a personal agenda, those that are selfish or greedy. We pray that despite that it's difficult, this leader will sit down and come up with sensible solution. We know your word told us in the last day there'll be war and rumors of war. But we know that it's not you, because you are gracious and compassionate God, abounding in love and slow to anger. And it's not you that want people to killing people. Your commandment is that do not murder. So, even though we know that you told us of war and rumors of war to happen, Lord, we know that the world is happening in accordance to your prophecy. We pray then, Lord, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Your kingdom come. So help us, Lord, to make sense of what's going around us. Help us to make our life ready for you. Tonight, I thank you for the privilege once again to stand before the very people whom you dearly love. Help me to speak and teach me what to say, so as to make your eternal word coming alive. Speak through me your doulos, so that, Lord, I can deliver a message that make impact in the life of all of us. So open our eyes, Lord, we shall see. Open our ear that we shall listen. Touch our heart, Lord, we respond to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I thank you for Sister Lydia who have beautifully read out for us Genesis 14. Because there are so many difficult names that I will struggle how to pronounce. You know, my English wasn't really good, but I was very thankful that she read for us. So I still like to point out and highlight some part of this war that recorded our meditation today according to, I would say, divine appointed schedule. Somehow it's on chapter 14 tonight. I started this series of Genesis some months back, and it's a divine appointment that we talk about the war, the very first war that mentions in the Bible. And this first war is a war of the nine kings. We heard that how they ended up in war because earlier on the five kings of the south was subjected to the four kings of the north. But in the 13th year, he said that they rebelled. So they came down all the way, the five kings swept through the entire land of Palestine. And the four kings fight again, the five kings. Then the four kings won. We were told in the story, isn't it? Walking on and sees all the goods of the Sodom and Gomorrah and all their food, and then they went away. And then it seemed that, might as well be carrying off Lot, the nephew of Abraham, since he was living in Sodom. And we heard Abraham being very first time mentioned in the Bible, the Hebrew. That's how the Israelite is known as the Hebrew. Very first time mentioned, Abraham, the Hebrew. When he heard about it, he called up his trained men, wow, his private army, and went in pursuit. And Sister Lydia had read for us all the difficult names from town to town, and how he routed them, he attacked them, and he managed to recover all the goods that and brought back. And it's on the way back from his victory, we heard that the king of Sodom came out to meet him. But then he read the next words, interestingly, is Melchizedek, king of Salem. Have a fellowship meal with him, and together they worship God and praise God, the Most High, who deliver your enemy into your hand. And the bread give a tenth of everything. And after that, Sodom City, you can take all, since you are the winner, you're the victor of this war. But Abraham said, I'm not going to do that. I will not accept anything. I want you to say that you make me rich. Accept some portion to the men that follow with me. So four kings of the north came all the way from that part of the north. You can see the four dashed line and come down all the way. Very likely, although the Bible, the sequence is a bit after, look like everything over, they met the five kings and fight. Very no. They meet the five kings somewhere here because the valley of Siddim is likely to be here. And then the southern kingdom, this light a bit too bright here, so cannot see. The southern kingdom is right here. And the four kings continue the conquest. The Endra is a march of conquest. We heard the tribal people, Rephite, Zuzite, Emite, Horite, Amalekite, and Morite. All in conquest by these four kings at the same time. Probably take away the plunder and spoil along the way. So today, tonight, we are looking at Abraham. How did he respond in this chaotic time? First, I think, interestingly, go quickly into is the issue of wealth in this chaotic time. We heard Abraham say that I will accept nothing belong to you. What is that nothing that Abraham talking about? And it is the spoil of the victory, isn't it? He had recovered the Bible, all the goods. And Bible only mentioned all the goods from Sodom and Gomorrah. But we know that this five king actually conquest, like conquered so many people. He changes the rest also he carried along. We are talking about a huge amount of goods or huge amount of valuable belonging. You know, but Abraham said, I'm not going to accept some that you're going to give to the line that went with him. I don't know whether have you ever picked up money from the root, no? You know, have you ever? Yeah, I did, but only coins. But I'm talking about large amount, no? And there was this family found nearly $1 million in cash in the middle of the road. Sunday, I don't even remember what this place in US, you know, in US. And it was a COVID time, May 2020. They were released from the MCO and came out, found 1 million cash in the middle of the road. And what did they do with the money? And according to the story, they give it to the police. They give it to the police. I don't know. Supposedly you found $1 million, you know? I never, only in my dream, maybe I found some dollar notes. You know? What would you do? Would you keep the money? It's in the middle of the road. See, nobody, say that the money belonged to them. Will you keep it? I think this family did the right thing. But I would say the small amount, you find $5, $10, you keep it, there's no concern. But big amount. Because the trouble with big amount of money, it may be illegal money, correct? And it may be really belong to someone is illegal. And actually, eventually, they found it belonged to the organizations. So it's so good that the family returned to them. So you see, Abraham don't want to accept anything from them. Although he has become the rightful owner because he was the victor of the war at the end. At the end of all this warfare, he is the victor. And he, as a result, has a right to everything that he has recovered. But he doesn't want anything, nothing Because early on we heard something about this country, Sodom and Gomorrah, right? But this country, this is a country that's sinning greatly against God. It's a country that's sinning greatly against God. The Bible told us this: better the little the righteous have than the wealth of many wicked, isn't it? Acquiring wealth, become rich, there's a principle. The principle is that there's an integrity in it. The right way to have it. Is that important? Sometimes, if people are not careful, they bend their principle a bit in acquiring wealth. But Abraham, from the beginning, he knew that. The Bible said that the wealth is accumulated this way. Dishonest money will dwindle away. But whoever gathers little by little will make it good. It's our diligence, our hard work, and our thrifty attitude that will make it grow. Then on the second point of wealth, Abraham said that I will never get from you because I want to make sure that you will never be able to say that you make me rich. I make Abraham rich. You see, the Bible again tells us not to envy the rich from the wicked one, or envy from people who are rich, because those who want to get rich in that way can fall into temptation and a trap. When we are too eager to acquire wealth in that manner, we didn't bother about how, where the source come from, we tend to fall into the trap. Which means certain business we know we wouldn't run. Nobody will be running a business that selling drugs, isn't it? I mean, I'm not talking about medicine, I'm talking about really abusing drugs. Although he make a lot of money, because the inventor of wealth, the Bible said that the Lord is the one. The Lord is the one who sent poverty and wealth from 1 Samuel. And then Deuteronomy again said that the Lord is the one who gives the ability to produce wealth. The Lord. Of course, when the Bible said it, it applied to all. Applied to entire humanity. But there are still evil people, wicked people, they become wealthy, unfortunately. Right? But what Abraham has shown, the integrity in acquiring, will make us stand true before God at the end. You know, although Abraham had yet to meet Jesus Christ, I think he understands this principle. He understands that it is Lord Jesus that will make us rich. Though he was rich, and yet for our sake, became poor. Jesus became poor so that by his poverty, the Bible says, that we might become rich. So he refused to let the king of Sodom to have the credit that who make Abraham rich. But he knows God is Jesus who made him rich. Of course, the rich here mentioned by 2 Corinthians meant more, because his richness in body, spirit, and soul as well, isn't it? Yes, money or wealth is important, but think about your spirit and soul is also rich. And you have a fine character, a beautiful personality. Wow, that's richness. It's beyond anyone could get. And Jesus wants to make us that way. He emptied everything so that we can reach in every aspect. Yes, some of us are certainly blessed with wealth. I'm one of those who don't. Yeah. I'm happy for it actually, because I know I worked before. I have worked in a multinational company before. I know too much money is never good for me. I thank God that I got a good wife. So I better surrender everything for her to manage. So plenty also she can manage. A little bit she also manage, also look like plenty. Very good manager. So how do we manage it? The question is that if we have wealth, if we really wealthy, how do we manage it? I think this line in the Luke chapter 16:9 is fantastic. He said that use worldly wealth to gain friends for yourself, so that when it's gone, you'll be welcome into eternal dwelling. This verse 19 is taken from the parable of the shrewd manager. Many of you who are very familiar with Bible will know it. That parable is quite a profound parable. It deserves a sermon by itself. But today I just want to show it to you that what Jesus meant here is use it for eternity. Use it for an eternal purpose. Use your wealth for the kingdom of God while you are on earth. Because we all know, right? No one can carry the wealth with us. And God has blessed certain people, some of you, wealthy, certainly, for the purpose of His kingdom, His eternity. So secondly, when I look at in this chaotic time of Abraham had the awareness, that the hand of God is in it. You see, the four kings were so powerful, shot through everything. They bypassed Abraham. They didn't go and attack Abraham. Abraham was a Hebron. It's just on the west side of the Jordan River. But he didn't. So he was able to then recognize that awareness of God's hand is in all of this that lead him to worship. Lead him to worship. And in the small, in the just a very a quick account that for us, chapter 14, show some important point about worshiping God. Do you notice that I said earlier, when Abraham returned from the victory, who came out and meet him? The king of Sodom. But interesting, right away after verse 70, the Melchizedek, king of Salem, was mentioned right away. Then after the Melchizedek, king of Salem, has been mentioned, then king of Sodom appeared again. Can't imagine him for a little while. He came by victory. The person first met him is king of Sodom, right? But then Melchizedek, king of Salem, was also there. Then it's like, oh, he's having a fellowship meal with Melchizedek, king of Salem, and together they worship God, praise God. Then after everything over, hey, then king of Sodom, you are still here. You can imagine the kind of scenario. Abraham is like, hey, I better do what is important in life first. The priority, you see? The priority, knowing that what is most important in life. Very interesting, my reading. And the second one, praise God. Knowing that every victory in our life is God, isn't it? It's God. Every victory. Yes, he got 318 men. We heard about it. Right? This week, the Bible, when he purposely mentioned in so detail, 318. You know, you read the Bible very often, it said 300 men, 1,000 men, or 10,000 men, or 100,000. Is it exactly 100,000? Definitely not lah. Maybe 99,945. They also say 100,000 lah, correct lah. Because how to can count? You so accurate. 100,000, isn't it? But do you see this so interesting? Here mentioned and you so accurate. 318. because each of the three men is so significant. They are elite military force, commander grade. But Abraham attributed his victory not to this 318 private army or elite military force, but to God. It's God. It's God. We use our wisdom to do what is right, but we have a clear awareness and understanding that God's hand is involved in our life. Every victory comes from God. Then the last one, Abraham gave a tenth of everything. When you worship God, you come with a present. You come with a present. Listen, a tenth of everything. The interesting question here then, a tenth of everything. What is the everything down here? Is it everything of that Abraham had? No lah, definitely not. In context, he tell you it's a spoil. The tenth of the spoil, right? The tenth of plunder that he had recovered from the four kings. And what about the rest of Abraham's money? Remember, Abraham is not poor. Abraham has a rich heritage. When he moved out all the way from the land of Ur to Haran to the land of Canaan, we heard that how he's moving all the sheep, goats, and all his maidservant and manservant following him. And when he goes down to Egypt, he acquired more donkey, sheep, cattle, camels, and then more manservant and maidservant. Right? Why would he say? Now, I want to hear, help all of us be careful living. There are false teaching all around. Especially from our so-called tithing, the tenth seems to be tithing. So let me sidetrack a little bit. I think I say this before about tithe and offering, right? And it gets very confused nowadays because we have this many health and wealth gospel say that you must tithe and you must tithe everything you have in life, huh? And give God everything, and then they make it so important that you tithe. Because you tithe, you want to have more, you tithe, and God will give you more. Because if you give, then God will make it multiply, right? Tenfold, 100-fold. Wow, I don't know whether it entice you to tithe or really teach you how to tithe properly. Yes, there is tithe and offering that been taught in the Bible. I don't want to go through again. I thought about this some time ago. But in the New Testament, is there tithe and offering? No. The answer is no. In the New Testament, if you really want to talk about offering, Jesus was standing at the temple court, looking at the people come into the temple treasury and put their offering, remember? And Jesus praised this old lady in two copper coin. Okay? And Jesus praised her because of what? Because he gave all. She picked up of her lack, out of poverty, and that two copper is all that she had. She gave all. So you really want to follow the early tithing in the New Testament? Give all. But no, he said, how much? Wow, this pastor God asked me to give all. How much then? And this is the teaching in the Bible. The teaching in the Bible is that whoever sow sparingly also reap sparingly. Where so generously also reap generously. The teaching of Bible in tithing or in offering is be generous. The principle is just be generous. And generous out of from your heart. He said everyone must give as he decided in his heart. Not reluctantly or under compulsion. I don't listen to my false message, I give all. Compelled to give. No. Not under compulsion or reluctant. For God loves a cheerful giver. He must be cheerful. He's a proper and cheerful giver. Now, there was this story about cheerful giving. You say that a priest, a pastor, a priest, and a rabbi, they gather together to talk about giving to God. The pastor said that this is how I give to God. I draw a circle on the ground. And I throw all my money up, and whatever that fall onto the circle, I give it to God. The priest said that I also have a similar method. I also draw a circle on the ground, and I also follow you. Throw all my money up. Whatever fall out the circle, I give it to God. The rabbi said, actually my method is similar, but I don't need to draw a circle. I just throw all the money up. If God wants to take, take up. The rest is mine. Anyway, it's just a joke. The most important is to be cheerful. Whatever method I fall out or fall in, cheerful giver. So what should be our offering? In fact, the New Testament has never said that you need to tithe. Okay? The principle is being generous, being cheerful, and last one is this. In view of God's mercy, our offering to God is offered ourselves. Ourselves more important. We live right with God more important. And that's a principle. It's not the money. If you don't have the right attitude, your heart is not correct. If you give a lot, there's no meaning. And you give little, cannot. Why not? Sometimes people ask me, I say, why not? Because your heart is right. You're correct. You know that yourself, giving of yourself is most important. And God knows you. We live in the new covenant, new testament. We live in the new age of the grace of God. Or new dispensation, I want to use the word, of the grace of God. And that grace of God is given to us that the Spirit of God is with us. So wonderful. The Spirit of God, who is real, is here. And the Spirit of God knows your heart. So if Abraham doing is not tithing, then what is it? What Abraham doing is something greater than tithing, because the Bible in Psalm 110 and Hebrews say that the Lord has shown and will not change his mind. You are a priest forever in the order of Melchizedek. If you go and read these two Psalms, then you know that they will refer to who? Jesus Christ. Hey, Jesus Christ. What Abraham has done is something greater, because Jesus Christ is the better hope, better covenant. And through the act of Abraham giving the offering, he recognized Jesus is a high priest. And that Jesus is a high priest, that then is a mediator between God and us. You see, the Thai original command, you go back and read carefully, was given to the priest, because the priest is the representative of the people. The people can't even go into the temple, right? Can't even enter into the holy of holy. But the priest, as a representative of people, take on the responsibility to go in and give the offering to God. That offering that they give, because it's imperfect, they have to do it year after year, year after year. But the Bible says that Jesus, being the priest forever in the order of Melchizedek, he's a priest that will live forever. And what did he offer as a representative for all of us? He offered himself also. He offered himself as a sacrifice, once and for all. So no longer the sacrifice is needed. So what Abraham did is, in recognition of the priest of the highest order to come, the real Melchizedek, Jesus Christ. So beautifully recorded down for us, because Abraham do that, you and I, who is a Gentile, we also then included. Because otherwise, the law were given to the Israelite or Jews, which required them to continue to do the offering, follow the ritual, follow the ceremony forever. Only Jews can have that salvation that come from God. But because it's by faith, you and I also receive it. So it's something that's so wonderful and so great. So finally, we come to this part in the time of the most chaotic moment in the life of Abraham. You read the story of Abraham, only one time he faced the war. And that war, there he is involved. And because the reason behind it, the five kings rebelled against the four kings, isn't it? The five kings rebelled. And the reason behind it, their rebellion is because their selfish agenda. Or reason behind the four kings come down and conquer them, there was a greedy agenda. And this is how the world that we are living in, we hear war here and there. On the survey, sometimes if we didn't know much, we thought that, oh, it's because of that. And then you know then the reason behind the war, you can get really shocked. Really shocked. By now, I'm not trying to I don't try to criticize America. By now you will know. A lot of time America involved in the war, there's a lot of agenda behind it. You see, that's how the war. And in this war, they're won by the four kings who carry away Lot, Abraham's nephew, who stayed in Sodom. You see, that's the other point about decision in life. Decision in life. Abraham, Lot chose to stay near Sodom at first. But come to this point, he actually stayed in Sodom. So there is the repercussions when we make decisions of our life. Lord chose to stay not only close to people of sin, now he stay inside the people of sin. The city of Sodom and Gomorrah, where they were sinning greatly against God. Of course, Abraham loved his nephew. Right? We heard how he sent out the 380 trained men. Unique commando grade military force. And still amazing, isn't it? He alone against four kings and he won. 380 and plus just a few of his alive won. Certainly, in that sense, God granted the victory. And he managed to recover all that they have taken away. Otherwise, Lord will be in greater danger if Abraham didn't go out and pursue them, attack them, and rescue him. He will suffer even greater loss. See, war is really an atrocity. Isn't it? War is really an atrocity. I think this 1 month you have bombarded enough news to talk about the Gaza war. Whether this, how this Gaza war will eventually develop, and whether it will end up with a World War III, right? I think you have bombarded. We are living in really in the world now that the technology is influencing every one of us. We receive immediate online news and so on and so forth. How it will eventually develop and go on, we really don't know. We really don't know. No one can predict. But one significant thing that I would say that we must take notes of the result of this war. The result. The result haven't come out yet. They were still fighting. You know, both sides are fighting. Continuous bombing each other. The result is significant. It's whether Israel, the nation of Israel, getting stronger or weaker. But whatever the result be, I think the event is happening according to the prophetic timeline of God. God is allowing all this to happen so that whatever He has spoken in the Bible is going to be fulfilled. Would Christian then be implicated in this war? Would you and I be affected in this war? Because after this, the important event of this result, the war will be there, whether the third temple will be built. You know, right? Third temple, the building of third temple is a very important milestone for the return of the Lord. And then persecution will come, the Bible says. Persecution will come. Do you know how fortunate you and I is right in this country? Firstly, no natural calamity. And nearly in the war zone, it's very scary. I look at the bombing that happened. I look at the no water, no electricity, no food. Very scary. But in the great tribulation to come, would it implicate us? I'm not very certain, but I think it may affect us a bit. Even we are here, because the word of God will stand true. We are affected a bit because of this word. He said, for then there will be great distress, unequal from the beginning of the world until now, and never to be equal again. If those days had not been cut short, no one would survive. And for the sake of the elect, the Bible said, those days will be short. We all know from the teaching of the Bible so that we are the elect, isn't it? Those who have faith in Jesus Christ are the elect, are chosen to be saved. And if you read just these two words itself, it's enough to tell you that the elect were in the middle of this great distress or great tribulation. God will cut short. God will cut short. Persecution can come even in Malaysia. The time can just change. And possible. We must be ready. But take comfort. Take comfort that Jesus has said before, if the pursuers come, we don't even need to answer. You have read this passage before? Say that the Holy Spirit will help us answer. And Jesus assure us, listing that I have spoken to you, that in me you might have peace. In this world you may have tribulation, but of good cheer, I have overcome the world. Jesus has overcome. The prophecy and the prediction of the Bible is after the persecution, there will be further war. Some may say that the Gaza war will lead to the war of Armageddon, the God and Mongol, but I don't think so. It's far after that, far after the temple being built, there will be a greater war. And in this war, they finally go against the Lord. And when the Lord come, if they will fight against the Lord, Revelation say that with the sword in his mouth, they all fall flat. Which is just simply mean that Jesus came as a king. He just, oh God. Isn't it? That's our mighty God. He is the one that will fight on our behalf. And his fight is just gone. And we will be delivered. Be sure that we will be delivered. Even though we may be in war, we will be delivered. Take comfort. Take assurance. Maybe chaotic moment may come onto Malaysia. Be ready. But we can take assurance. Because in Christ, we are in Christ. Even those times we may be made rich. How to use our richness is important. All the more you and I will understand that end time is very close. Use the wealth and riches for the kingdom of God, for eternity. So now you know why I'm happy and poor, right? Because it's very difficult when you are rich. And this is the word of God that I share with you. Because at the end of it, God said that, show me your account. My one very easy. Finish using. Okay? Then we have been represented and redeemed in Christ. So nice, right? Our hope is sure and certain. We have a priest of the order of Melchizedek. He represents us. He's our advocate. He speaks on our behalf. Now all this can be perfect. Okay? Now all this is perfect. Don't go back so worried that I don't know how to use my money or so how. Don't worry. We have the priest of Melchizedek. He will speak for us. And the Bible all the time tells us, assure us that God is gracious. God is good to us. And finally, we shall be recovered even if we are in the middle of tribulation. Some say they know that maybe we will pour up before the tribulation. But I tend to believe that we may be in the midst of a bit. Just like the Lord was taken away by the four kings for a while. But Jesus will come. Jesus will recover. Abraham will recover Lord, and Jesus will recover us. And that recovery is fantastic. Prophesied by Paul in 1 Thessalonians 7. He said that in the twinkling of an eye, with a loud command, with the trumpet call of God, the day arises. All who are the elect or were the elect when they die, they arise first. You're talking about the body will rise first. Because all who have gone ahead of us, the soul and spirit already in heaven, is a new body, glorious body that will rise. And you and I in the twinkling of an eye, we will join them in the air. Because we will be transformed. Transform and join the Lord in the end. The Lord will recover all His people before greater distress, greater persecution will come. And that's our hope. And our hope are solidly skilled in the promise of God, in the prophecy of God. I think you heard me say many times, happily anticipating the day, because it means that I can fly. Then only I can meet God in the air. Of course, oh, you can fly together. How nice, isn't it? So be assured, even though we are living in a time of chaotic, but again, be alert. Be ready. Let's give thanks to God. Dear God and Father, we thank God for even a timely arrangement of message that remind us again to trust and rely on you. Believe that you are sovereign, you are in charge, and all our victory belong to you. And you are God, the mighty one. Your king wants to be a savior of the world. You will come against as a king of the world. And at that time, you will recall us. You will call us together with you. So help us live this moment of our life. That offering ourselves as a living sacrifice to you. That our heart, our attitude, personality and our faith is in you all the time. So thank you and praise you for the hope that you have given to us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You shall have the Holy Communion. Let's give thanks to God with a heart of praise, the privilege that we can have, and prepare ourselves spiritually for the partaking of the Lord's Supper. We thank our Lord Jesus Christ, who himself instituted the Holy Communion on the night of Passover before his crucifixion, and subsequently revealed the instruction to Apostle Paul, who written down for us in 1 Corinthians 11. So let's listen to the instructions and follow in the Spirit. For I received from the Lord, also I pass on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Therefore, whoever eats the bread or drink the cup in an unworthy manner will be sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. A man ought to examine himself before he eats the bread or drink of the cup. For anyone who eats and drink without recognizing the body of the Lord eats and drink judgment unto himself." Let's pray. Dear Father, we thank you for the celebrations of the Holy Communion that we can have in Jesus' name. In your holy and glorious presence, we were unfit even to pick up the crumbs under your table. But because of your great love and mercy for us, you called us into your being, crafted us in with your people as one holy nation, and seated us in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus. Dear Lord Jesus, we thank you for the institutions of the Holy Communion. We praise you for your unconditional love and the sacrifice of yourself on the cross for our transgressions and sin. Now in you, we have redemption through your blood, the forgiveness of sins, in accordance with the riches of your grace that you lavish on us with all wisdom and understanding. Dear Lord Jesus, we praise you that for us, you have sanctified yourself, so that we too may be truly sanctified. Thank you for praying for all us that we may be one, just as you and the Father are one, that we may be in you and the Father in complete unity, so that the world may believe that the Father has sent you and that you have sent us into the world. Thank you for giving us the glory that the Father has given you, that you and the Father have loved us so much. May you bless us this time of fellowship and communion that we can have before this table. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I invite all members who are baptized and confirmed to partake this Holy Communion with us. If you have been breaking the bread and taking the cup in your church, do feel free to join us in doing so. But if you have not baptized or confirmed or suspended, please refrain from taking. As the server come, took out one and peel off the top layer first, because the second layer is the cup, and you peel the one and spill it. The bread that you have is the body of Christ given for you. Eat of it and be thankful in remembrance of it. The cup in your hand is the blood in the new covenant of our Lord Jesus Christ. Drink of it and be thankful in remembrance of Him. Let us pray. Dear Father, we thank you for choosing us before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in your sight. In love, you have predestined us to be adopted as your sons and daughters through Jesus Christ. In accordance with your pleasure and will, to the praise of your glorious grace, which you have freely given us in Christ whom you love. And you make known to us the mystery of your will, according to your good pleasure, which you have purposed in Christ, to be put into effect when the times will have reached their fulfillment. To bring all things in heaven and on earth together, under one head, our Lord Jesus Christ. Dear Lord Jesus, we are privileged to be accepted before your holy presence in the Spirit. And through the partaking of this sacrament, we are now united with you as one body. We thank you for calling us, saving us, making us into the body of yours, which is your church. Now as a body, your church, may you direct our paths and guide our ways. May you strengthen us and empower us to move forward to achieve the purpose of the plan you have for us. Help us be bold and courageous to be your witnesses in this last day. Transform us and mold us to be Christ-like. Equip us and empower us by the Holy Spirit to share the good news to the lost. Thank you. And we pray this in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Collect back the waste and cup.
Now rise for our closing song.
Oh.
himself, the God of peace, sanctify you true and true. May your whole spirit, soul, and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. The one who calls you is faithful, and he will do it. The Lord God Almighty bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.